The issue that springs to my mind is one that relates to the conflicts that a lot of young people have between what they're taught as scientists at universities and what they're taught in meetings such as this. And one issue that is, I think, at the forefront of that is the general approach. And the approach that you are putting forward is that you find truth through introspection, through subjective awareness, and so on. And what we are taught in universities and what scientists often teach us is that your senses deceive you, your mind deceives you, and you should never trust anything that you experience unless you have an objective verification of that. And even William James, that you mentioned earlier, said that at every corner, at every turn, our senses deceive us. So how do you resolve those conflicts?
Okay. First of all, let me introduce Narendra Bhai, who just asked the question. He's a neuroscientist, so he's in full right to challenge any ideas of religion and, you know, go to the heart of the matter and say, but there are issues here which do not really sit well with, say, the ideas of science or empirical science. So how do you reconcile? Marvelous question. I'll give you a very fast crash course on logical positivism from which this question arises. This is what it says. The logical positivists are the people who say, look, we are fed up of fluffy stuff entering the field of science. We want science to be pristine and pure and clean cut, and we hate fluffy stuff entering our field. This is how we are trying to put a simple language, simple gloss on a very complex thing. So they say the following. They say, we will only accept as a statement as being meaningful. They see the word meaningful. Again, you see straight away, that word is now already kind of lighting up. Meaning, what do you mean by meaningful? But let's go along with this idea. We'll only consider a statement to be meaningful, flashing lights, meaning, what do you mean by meaningful? Everything is meaningful. Meaningful if it can be verified by empirical evidence. What is empirical means it can be verified by sense experience. Now, Narendra Bhai himself says sense experience are risky. But this empiricist said, well, this is the best we have got. So unless there's a little click on my oscilloscope or something happens and say, yes, I can visually see a little track here left by this electron, I will not relate to it. It must be something that my five senses, you know, my seeing, etc., I can tabulate it. I need it to be kind of, I must have my five senses grab hold of it. It must be an empirical evidence. Okay, this is one part. Secondly, they said, now, whatever evidence I gather, I'm going to produce, if you like. Now, this is the part where, without realizing it, these logical positivists are entering the field of non-empirism, or if you like, non-materialism, by saying that we will produce a thought system, if you like, a particular model, which will, in a way, allow me to give a congruent or a coherent explanation of the events that I observe in front of me. This is how science progresses. I do an experiment. Certain things that I can verify with my senses, yes, this is no poetry. And now I've got a theory that will explain this particular set of events or objects, how they're interrelated. And that theory I call a theory of gravitation, electromagnetism, or neuroscience. So I've got a mental model. I'm already using a mental model. This is not something that can be reduced to sense data. A mental model, which is almost a metaphysical model, plus empirical evidence, and I'm going to combine the two, and anything that kind of agrees with a kind of coherent, you know, cogent mental model fitted with empirical evidence, that I call meaningful. The rest I call poetry. Good if you like poetry, good for you, keep singing, good for you. It's not empirical science. This is how they try to divide. Now, this particular journey was going very well until science stepped into the 21st and 20th century. The science then suddenly discovered that what it was relying on, the material world and the empirical evidence, suddenly appeared to be not set in stone, but made of standing on sand, quicksand in fact, not even steady sand. It began to disappear under their feet. So the reason why I take great pride in studying quantum mechanics, because this is the way I can trump a neuroscience, hopefully, is to bring out quantum. And again, this is the same thing. This is what they're telling us. They're saying that you want to reduce everything to matter, lump of matter, and its attribute, its spin, its charge, its mass. My friend, says quantum mechanics, this is the heart of all the sciences, including all the biological science, all the physical science, that say, oh dear, when you try to grab hold of this thing, the material thing, it just vanishes. It just appears as nothing but a wiggle in existence. It's just a wiggle, a dance of existence. There is no material thing underpinning this material world. So you say, in that case, what are we sitting on? Just a wiggle of existence. So suddenly we discover that empiricism and the idea of relating everything to just matter and its any epiphenomena is suddenly on a its own quicksand, doesn't have a solid foundation, itself is shaky to the core. That is why since the 1920s, every scientist, including this great Einstein, they're pulling their hair out because they can't allow that. The objective reality has disappeared and replaced by a mathematical reality, a metaphysical reality. So quantum is no longer defined as a material kind of science. It is purely a mathematical conjecture. Pure mathematics, nothing else. If you'd ask what is the psi function, they say, don't ask. We have no idea. But it fits and it gives us answers about your DNA, about your computer chip. But we are now entered into a realm where we don't have the vocabulary for it. But the only thing we can say is non-material. So suddenly empiricism itself. Look, the reason why I love science, that's why I'm very pleased that I did science, is this. It is through this very one-pointed, very focused, a system with tremendous integrity. That's why you must bow down to science. Look, why can't you? Look, in just 100 years, the lifespan of whole of humanity has been doubled because of the advance of science, of allopathic medicine. Doubled. In the name of science, look, sand, you know, silicon, sand. You can put it in a little chip here. And you get all these marvelous pictures and you can interact, communicate, and as Tony said, internet, everything. Just sand. And this has happened by a very focused approach in science, which produces all these marvelous gizmos. It allows us tremendous way of harnessing reality. Do not take anything away from science and do not attack its integrity. So this idea of spirituality that comes from Vivekananda is not attacking the integrity. In fact, it says, please carry on. Take your science to its conclusion. And if you find that we are not meeting up, then you challenge us. But we are meeting up. And that's how I finished my first session. It is here the science kind of shakes hands with spirituality. All this is a wiggle in existence, Akash and Prana. Even, you see, everything, look, all the faculties we possess, the material world, you know, okay, look, solid. Underpinning it is, if you like, a mental world that we use to make sense of the world. You can't avoid it. Suppose I say, how do I see the universe? Sorry, I must go on. You see, suppose I see a table in front of me. The table doesn't go inside my brain and knock and say, okay, I'm here. I just get sensation. The sensations are now projected on the back of my retina. From there, they go to some inner center in my brain. From where, how does this objective kind of information translate into a subjective experience? The neuroscience have no clue. What is this thing that turns objective reality into a subjective experience? What is this patch of pink? This is how they define it. We have difficulty in, this is called the hard problem of consciousness. It becomes a serious issue. So here you see, it's already now showing that you can no longer keep physical away from the metaphysical. You need to tie them together. And all the kind of mature scientists, whether it's Niels Bohr or Werner Heisenberg or Paul Dirac, are recognizing there is more to us than meets the eye. So reducing everything to matter in sub-phenomena will not take us far. That's why science is shuddering. Shuddering is the right word. And where is the biggest shudder? Quantum, it wins. This is where suddenly the doorway of spirituality has been opened up for the whole of humanity. We are no longer limited to a stodgy materialistic worldview. It has been broken free. And again, you see, when I see this marvelous term, like, Richard, listen, you must give full marks to Richard Dawkins. I'm trying to make friends with him through this. Is this. This guy says, look, first reduces us to this little gene called the selfish gene. And then how does he conclude his story about the selfish gene? People don't read the conclusion. They just start the beginning as a horrible man. He's saying there's no God and it's all just genes. This man is saying, but what humanity has learned is this. We do not play along with the selfish gene. We fight the tyranny of the selfish gene. We want to break free from the, if you like, the materialistic agenda of the gene. This is what humanity is about. Otherwise, we'll continue to be like animals biting each other, you know, killing each other. Only the superior wins, the survival of the fittest. That is not Richard Dawkins. He said, we must step back. Why should we step back? He said, I don't know, but we as human beings must fight the tyranny of the... You see, he's becoming spiritual without using the word spiritual. He hates the word. He hates religions. Let him. The more passionate he is, the more spiritual I see him.